How real is that truce in the Labour Party?
Well, it isn't a truce in the sense that we've ever been at war. But in May 79, the Labour government, of which I was a member, was very badly beaten after having been in office since 64 with a break. And that was the time when you really had to look at the policies and also look and see how the next Labour government could be, if you like, a bit more accountable for what it did. So for a couple of years or more, a number of us have worked, a majority in fact, to try and get a new policy on the common market, a new policy on peace to get rid of American bases, and a policy that could give us 4 million jobs and to get some changes that would make it more likely that a Labour government would carry it through. Now that phase is over and we are now coming together really to try and win public support for those policies. So it's not exactly a truce, it's a new stage in the process of trying to do the job that the Labour Party asks us to do.
How important do you think it is that both factions of the party should be seen to be together?
Well, I believe it very strongly. The Labour Party is a very broad church. It's made up of a lot of different elements. A lot of the origins of socialism in Britain come from the Christian religion, the Christian socialists, the Fabians. Karl Marx wrote in the British Museum and has always been accepted as a part of the trade unions. And left, right and centre come together to try and represent the interests of what you would broadly call those working people. That's the professional managers and professional people and those who work in industry and women who work at home, though they're not paid for it in terms of wages, to represent those interests. And so clearly we work out a programme and then campaign for it. But within it there's a very exciting debate going on, and I don't think the Labour Party will ever split. It loses a few people, but it will never split.
Do you still regard yourself, as you did at the end of last year, as the true deputy leader of the Labour Party?
Well, what I was saying really was that if the defectors had left before they voted in the Electoral College, the result would have been different. That was the point I was really making. In fact, it was a very even division between the two, between Denis Healy and myself. And the party has to work together in order to really, I believe, honestly save this country from the disaster of unemployment, the threat of war, and the tyranny of the common market. So we're brought together by our need to do our proper job. But the debates will go on, and I wouldn't want to be in a Labour Party where everybody took the same view.
At the Bishop Stortford conference, everybody wanted to know and get an undertaking from you whether you would stand again before the next general election as deputy leader against Denis Healy. Now, your silence was almost deafening at the time. Are you still silent about that?
Well, it was never raised. It wasn't to discuss that. Nobody asked me, and I didn't ask other people, you know, whether they would support Peter Tatchell or whether they would support the policy. We got together to try and work out how we could campaign effectively to bring our policies out to the public as a whole. And I believe that if the party rallies round the policies we've agreed at the conference and accepts that the new democratic constitution should really remain, and we don't expel people and all that, which I'm very much against, even people I disagree with. I think we should keep everyone in the party. On that basis, I think the party will work together and be able to do the job it's meant to do, which is to protect people in this country from the tragedy that is now engulfing us.
But a lot of people central in the party are desperate that you should give some kind of undertaking as to whether or not you are going to stand against.
Well, funnily enough, people ask me on television programmes and ask me, you know, journalists ask me, but I was there with all the leaders of the Labour Party for 2 days and nobody raised it.
Well, I am now then.
Yes, well, I think the point is this: the party's worked for the right to elect a leader, and I don't own the electoral rights of the Labour Party. And I think what we've got to do now is to go flat out now, all of us, for a very big election majority next time, because we'll need more than half the people in this country to support us if we're going to carry through the policies. And if that is the objective, everything else is secondary. But of course, we've got to be sure that the policies we've agreed are adhered to, that there isn't an attempt to roll back the clock, and that we don't expel people. So that, I mean, everybody knows, I think, that the left, having worked for 2.5 years to achieve many of these things, is now going to throw its full weight into an election victory, and all other questions, dare I say it, are secondary.
So can we be absolutely sure then, provided things don't change, the status quo doesn't change, you won't stand against Denis Healy?
Well, I don't think it would be sensible for me to speak on behalf of others. The decision I took last year was taken after a lot of consultation and a lot of pressure, frankly, and I don't think it's for me to speak as if I was an individual in these cases. What I am saying, and I wouldn't want anyone at home to be in any doubt, I'm not really in any sense evading your question, the Labour Party now has got to go flat out to persuade people that there is an alternative to the tragedy of unemployment and the risk of war and the tyranny of Brussels. And if we do that, then I think the whole party will rally around its present policy, and that's the way we should proceed. Now, that's how it was, as it were, thought of at Bishop Stortford. That's the way I see it now.
Mr. Benn, you've used a lot of ifs there. Now, if it meant that the Labour Party would lose the next election, unless you sacrificed some of your principles, diluted some of the policies you've fought so hard to win within the party, would you be willing for those sacrifices, those dilutions?
I've never seen it that way, do you know, to be honest. In the last Labour cabinet, I was in a minority. You showed a little bit of film about the common market, but the longer we were in, the more I became persuaded that was really a disaster for Britain. I was opposed to the pay policy and the economic policy, but I stuck it out because I wanted to see that we had a Labour government if we could. We were smashed in 79. And there's no prospect, in my view, of the Labour government being elected again if we were to go back to a pro-nuclear, pro-pay policy, pro-common market line. So I think people respond. I may be wrong, and perhaps some of the people who are watching will phone in and say this. I think what people want is for those in public life or politics to speak their mind and say what they think. And if you say that, I think you're more likely to get support than if you fudge.
Well, you've been accused of being many things, but I don't think anyone has ever said you were an opportunist. You've been a man of principle, well, even though those principles have changed slightly over the years.
Well, I've learned from experience, Elaine, but the point I'm really making is this. If people ask you for a view, I think you have to give your view. You may have to say at the end, well, this is my view, but I'm in a minority, and I think we should go along with what the majority say. But what I don't think you can do is to pretend you don't believe something in order to win support.
I'm glad you said belief.
Yeah,
because
it is about
the
belief.
View is based upon belief or faith.
Must be.
And you came from a household that was both political and religious. There's really not that much difference between the two activities in one way, is there?
Well, you've only got to watch the Borgias, as I did, for one or two items that I got fed up with them, to realise that at that time the Vatican was a bit like many cabinets in all parts of the world. It was very political, of course. The Church has always been very political as an organised religion, that's true.
So faith means knowing that you are right?
No, I don't think that's right, no, because I've changed my mind. You pointed that out. I mean, I change my mind quite often if I'm persuaded I'm wrong. I think faith is believing what you're saying. Secondly, the test of credibility is that if you're heard speaking in the cabinet or at a public meeting or even at home, you'll be heard saying the same thing. Mm-hmm. You know, you're not adjusting it to meet people's preferences. But above all, that it is in some way rooted in a set of principles of belief. But that may be reflected in different policies at different times. And I've made lots of mistakes, and these have been pointed out, and I've changed my mind about them over the years.
Well, then, does it ever terrify you in the small hours of the night that you might change your mind 2 years from now?
No, it doesn't frighten me, because I would be a very stupid man if I didn't listen to what was said to me. I do listen, and people... I got 20,000 letters last year, partly because I was ill, but people write enormously long letters. And on the basis of argument, I've shifted my opinion, particularly my experience as an industrial minister.
I was wondering if I could quote. I know that Cromwell is not one of your heroes, but somebody who you respect as a man of principle in the past. Mm. I beseech you in the bowels of Christ, sir, think it possible you may be mistaken. Perhaps that should be engraved on the heart of every politician.
Oh, I agree with that. Mind you, there are ways of persuading you, you know. They just defeat you. I mean, in the 1979 period, we were beaten because the public didn't agree with the policy. Mm. So they didn't have to beseech us, they got rid of us. And the great thing about the democratic process, and why I'm so passionately keen on democracy, and everything I've written is about sharing power, is that whoever you are, however good you may be, if you have power, you're corrupted by it. And the only way you can safeguard system of government from being corrupted by those in power is by conveying the power to sack them, to dismiss them, to get rid of them, to more and more people. That should apply in industry. That's why I'm in favour of workers' control. That's why we should get rid of the House of Lords, because they're accountable to nobody. That's why we should have much more open government and, in my opinion, a more diverse media so people can hear the arguments before they make up their mind.
Well, Jenny Fletcher from Ryslip, I think the media are biased against the Labour Party. They emphasise a lot of the trivial party infighting at the expense of policy coverage. Does Mr Benn agree, and what can be done? And one for Arthur Wilde of Burnley. The media treats the political philosophies of Labour and Conservative parties sensibly, but militants, Trotskyists, etc. are treated in a very derisory way. Why is this?
Well, partly because of the people who own the media. If you take Fleet Street, all the newspapers in Fleet Street and most of the local papers, the chains of local newspapers, are owned by two multinational companies and five rich men. And quite honestly, they reflect the views of their proprietors. If you take the common market, and we saw that little clip at the end of the referendum, there were 8 million people who voted no, and not a single newspaper, not a commercial newspaper, supported the anti-case. So I think that's part of it. And I feel about the BBC and ITN too, that they are very hostile to Labour. Now, if you take the second question about people outside the mainstream, you see, compare it with the way religions are treated. Gerald Priestland has just done a marvellous series about Christianity, and he's gone to the Mormons and the Quakers and all the different denominations, and he's asked them what they think, and they've been treated with respect. Now, within the various or huge family of socialism, there are all sorts of people, different views, and I'm in favour of treating minorities with respect, whether I agree with them or not. And at the moment, anyone who is to the left of the Guardian is treated as if he was in some way wicked or evil or an extremist or a revolutionary or dangerous. And that deprives people at home of access to the full range of information. So it's in the ownership of the media that we get the bias, and the presentation does less than justice to the immensely diverse tradition of opinion we have in Britain.
What's the answer, though? I read in your book, Arguments for Socialism, that you anticipate that the trade unions should run their own paper. But didn't they do that with the Daily Herald?
That's one way. Imagine the Daily Herald folded when it had a circulation of 2 million, which was twice as big as the Times or the Guardian, folded because the advertisers wouldn't support a Labour paper. No, I think we've got to do, if I pursue the parallel of religion for a moment, on the religious services on a Sunday, you get Catholic churches, you get the Jewish religion, synagogues, putting on their own services. And I would like to see the handling of schools of political thought treated with the same sensitivity that they treat the handling of schools of religious or different religious denominations. That would help. And I think also we should try and find a way of getting greater diversity. I'm dead against state-controlled press, absolutely opposed to that. But I think people ought to be able to get hold of a paper or watch a programme that reflects their view occasionally. And one of the reasons there's so much violence, I think, in our society is because people, particularly working people, can turn on the television or read a paper and they never see anybody defending their case like the as-left drivers.
Still on the question of minorities, political minorities. Mr. Rick Singh from Leytonstone, aren't you, using the Labour Party as a political platform to put forward your own personal minority views rather than following general Labour Party policies?
No, as a matter of fact, that's wrong, because what I'm arguing are the policies of the Labour Conference. I happen to agree with them. I don't always agree with Labour Conference policies, but I do believe that the TUC and the Labour Party have agreed on three very important policies: that we should escape from the Treaty of Rome and have a new relationship with Europe, that we should not have nuclear weapons, and we should get rid of the American bases. And I'm putting those views forward against the views, really, of a minority of the party.
Do you know, I'm going to be rude to, Mr. Singh.
Yeah.
No, not to you. I often think that when people say Labour Party, they mean Labour voters. The Labour Party is comparatively small compared to the vast electorate.
Well, you don't know what the Labour voters think, but you see, if I relate it to the question you put earlier, if I'm just somebody who opens the public opinion polls and I find that 80% are in favour of this and 70%, am I then just to get up and say, well, I agree with that? I think I owe people, I mean, they deserve from somebody who is a representative the right to know what he thinks. Now, if my view doesn't prevail, I'm defeated. That's the mechanism by which I'm controlled, if you see what I mean, anybody in my position. If I can't carry the Labour conference, I become a minority. If you lose an election, you become a minority. But you have to try as hard as you can to put forward the views you hold in the party, and if the party accepts them, to put them forward to the public. And then if you win, but only if you win, will you have a chance of doing them.
Two here who are concerned about your thoughts on communism. Roy Rain from Norwich. What's the difference between left-wing Labour supporters and communists? Mr. Benn sounds more like a communist to me.
He's been reading the papers.
And Geoffrey Cuckoo, if that's right, from York, can you state yes or no without frills whether if a Labour government came to power, it would implement any communist policies?
Well, the Labour Party is based upon socialism, and the roots of socialism in Britain go back many centuries. Last year we celebrated the Peasants' Revolt, when the Reverend John Ball, who was a priest and a militant, said things will not be well in England till all things are held in common ownership, 1381. And as a matter of fact, although Marx was a formidable philosopher, and he died long before Stalin came to power, the British Labour Party drew its socialism from its own experience. And I've never been a member of any other party but the Labour Party, and I never would be. So that I think the reason that the people who put in questions like that put them in is that the press, unable to answer the questions we're raising, say, oh, well, that man's a communist, he's a Trotskyite. And it's a form of abuse to prevent people from hearing the argument. The Labour Party is a deeply democratic party. The trade unions campaign for the vote for working people. We've no more connection with Stalinism or Russian communism than we had with Christianity during the Inquisition. You could say we're a Christian country, but look at the Inquisition. Therefore, Christianity means torture and all that. So that I think that the people who put the question in have genuinely been misled. And anyone who knows anything about the Labour Party is that its great passion is for democracy, and it doesn't believe you could have socialism unless people agreed to it by a majority, and I believe that most strongly.
Sidney Jones, West Kirby, Merseyside, of course. Do you see a place in your new society for the royal family?
Well, the Labour Party has never raised this question. And the reason is because
Mr. Jones did.
Well, I mean, I haven't got a society, you know, because if I've got a blueprint and given half a chance, I'll pull it out of the cupboard and it will be imposed on people. The truth is we have a constitutional monarchy in this country. That is to say that the functions of the Crown are exercised in the light of the decisions of the House of Commons. Now, the only politician who got rid of a king in my lifetime was a Conservative Prime Minister, Mr. Baldwin, who got rid of Edward VIII because he wanted to marry Mrs. Simpson. Very dramatic if you watch those Edward and Mrs. Simpson programs. The Labour Party, and I'm trying to represent their policy, takes the view that we would expect that the Crown would respect the decisions of an elected Labour government to carry through policies on which we were elected, including the abolition of the House of Lords, which is an outrage that there should be people sitting in Parliament by inheritance or patronage. And we would expect that the Crown would behave constitutionally with the Labour government as it has done with the Conservative government. And that is the answer to the question. I have no blueprint. I have no Ben's Britain. I'm trying genuinely to put forward the policies of the Labour Party and get them accepted.
Can I very briefly ask you, you mentioned abolishing the House of Lords, and many people are still convinced that you were born as the son of a peer. You don't come from a long line of privilege and landed barons, do you?
No, but the press say that again, you see.
Well, then what was your grandfather?
Well, my grandfather, John Benn, went to work at the age of 11 as an office boy. He ended up as chairman of the London County Council and was a member of Parliament. My other grandfather was born the son of a tailor in Irvine in Ayrshire, and he got a scholarship and went to a school and ended up as a school teacher and also a member of Parliament. But you see, the communist question and the aristocrat question are both put in the papers because the papers have to find some way of discouraging people from listening to what I'm saying. So if they could say he's a communist aristocrat, who's going to listen to him? If they actually knew that I was a democratic socialist and the son of a Labour MP at the end of his life was made a peer, then of course what I say would be more listened to. So I know, I recognise all this now, and that's why it's said it's not people make a mistake. That is a deliberate Fleet Street campaign, I think.
Some hear about unemployment,
yes,
which is obviously very much in the news at the moment. Mr. Davis from Eastbourne, Mr. Benn claims that his policies will cure unemployment in this country. What makes him think he can cure a problem which is worldwide? Alfred Mahoney of Crayford, what would you do to combat unemployment if Labour win the next election? And Mr. Ward, Bill Ward from Chesterfield, I'm unemployed. What would a future Labour government do to create new jobs?
We debated this in the House of Commons yesterday. And you see, to create 4 million jobs, which is what we'd have to do, would be an enormous task. And just electing Labour ministers to run the system won't be enough. And that's why I think it's so important we don't make it seem that the only political argument is between who's going to run British capitalism best. If you were going to try and do it seriously, and that's what we've said, you'd have to make some very significant changes. For example, you'd have to put the oil revenues, which are now leaking abroad or going into unemployment pay, you'd have to just be absolutely sure they went into industry. You'd have to expand health and education. You'd have to have a big housing program. And anyone who goes around with a pencil and paper and makes a list of what needs to be done, old people who need care, young people who need education, the sick who need medical treatment, that's where the jobs are going to come from. We should cut defence spending. It's criminal that old people should be dying of cold, as they are now, in their hundreds this winter, and we should be spending money on nuclear missiles. That's just absolutely, fundamentally wrong. And similarly, the council house tenants should have their rents doubled as they have in 2.5 years, while money is wasted on other things, and unemployed building workers, who could build council houses that we need, are unemployed, and there's a longer waiting list for homes. So I think you'd have to act very directly, and it would be a big job. I think you've got to have earlier retirement, you've got to have a shorter working week, you've got to have sabbatical years for people to go into education, in adult education. It could be done, but I have to say that if you tried to do it, it would involve a pretty big change in what's called monetarist or market forces, or if you like, capitalism. You'd have to put first things first, and there is hope, but not on the present basis.
Mm-hmm. A revolutionary change, perhaps?
Well, revolution is such a funny word, isn't it? I mean, I believe people in reform.
But you said a big change. So.
Well, a big change, but after all, we're having a pretty big change now. Mm-hmm. To have 3 million people out of work is a really revolutionary change. Think of the people watching this programme, and I expect a lot of unemployed watching at home in the afternoon now. Their lives have been destroyed. And look at the people waiting for medical treatment. Look at the old people who have to go to bed because they're so cold. Look at all the school leavers. Over 60% will be unemployed. They've suffered an absolutely revolutionary change in their prospects. And I think it's wrong. And I really do passionately believe that we've got to do something active to try and improve the prospects for our people.
Now, you're talking about our people. Here's a question from Daisy Drage from Langdon in Essex. When you go to meetings, how do you really know what ordinary people want and need?
Well, let me answer that in two ways. First of all, I mentioned all the letters that I've had, 15 or 20,000 this last year. I've been a Member of Parliament now for 32 years this November. I've had, I suppose, in that period, 35 or 40,000 cases, not just letters, from people in that area about their pensions, their homes, their brother who's in trouble, their aunt who can't get medical treatment, their
son. But surely all MPs have that kind of information.
Well, but then the truth is that you have to listen. I'm not making myself special in any sense. Of course I'm not. I'm only saying that if you represent an area, as I have done for such a long period, nothing that goes on really isn't brought to your attention. So the answer to the question, how do you know? People tell you. Why do you listen? Because if you don't, they can fire you. And that's where the democratic process and the educational process of the MP go hand in hand.
And is each and every letter, each and every request responded to? Where do you find the time?
Well, I have two people who help at home. One is a councillor and the other helps as well. And, I mean, the time is occupied in dealing with these letters, and I'm going to do my surgery tomorrow morning in Bristol, and people will come along. And that's how you learn. And if you ever get it wrong, people tell you, you know, very quickly. They put you on the right lines.
A lot of interest, of course, about the SDP. Mm. Mrs. Joanne Forrester, we'll just do this one from Seven Oaks, because there are many. Do you think the Labour Party will survive the SDP?
Oh, yes, I do. I think the SDP is really a very right-wing party. In a funny way, it's more right-wing than Mrs. Thatcher. Because Mrs. Thatcher is an old-fashioned liberal, if you know what I mean. She believes in market forces and small government. But my knowledge and experience of the SDP is that they believe in a centralised system. They believe in a federal Europe in which we would only be a province under Brussels. They believe in retaining the American bases. They want a statutory pay policy, so they would govern the wages of everybody without proper negotiation. I think they're a very hard right party. And I think the Labour Party, which has now got a decent policy result of all the work we've done, is going to pick up a lot of support this year. And I feel sorry for Liberals, many, you know, radical grassroots Liberals, who really don't agree with the SDP, but they've been conscripted and put in uniform in order to put these four ex-MPs back into Parliament, or four leaders back into Parliament. And I think lots of young Liberals are going to join the Labour Party. I've had lots of letters, funnily enough, from Liberals who now feel the Labour Party is a party they'd like to join.
But the SDP is doing phenomenally well at the moment, isn't it?
Well, it's had a lot of support from the press. Well, I mean, honestly, I'm worried. Of course I'm worried. But then when there's unemployment, people swing to the right. People are frightened. And the characteristic of the Labour Party is a party of hope. And of the right wing, it is a party of fear. You frighten people into accepting it. And therefore, when people are frightened, they will swing to the right. And one of the reasons they swing to the SDP is because it is a right-wing party. And in Germany before the war, there were 6 million unemployed, and it, you know, threw up a very right-wing government. And I think that the Labour Party has got to give people the faith and confidence to believe that we could do better than we're doing. And I believe that, and when that happens, then Labour's support will return.
Question from Manchester, from June Berry. What guidelines would you give to Labour-controlled local authorities to resist the government cuts and protect the people who voted for those Labour local authorities?
Well, I think the first thing is that Labour councillors should keep very close to the Labour Party. In Manchester has been an argument, as a matter of fact, and in some other areas. I think Labour councillors elected on a Labour programme should keep very close to the trade unions, because thousands of jobs are going, and to the Labour Party. I can't advise them on what to do, except to say this, that local democracy is being destroyed by Mr. Heseltine. And look at London with the fares, where they elected people to cut the fares, and now Lord Denning, who is very anti-parliamentary, he believes the judges should govern the country, in my opinion, and Mr. Heseltine, are coming in and they're destroying local democracy.
So
and local
you can't find any way to resist, that was the question.
Well, I think they must decide how best to do it, recognising that they're not just defending the Labour Party or their policies, they're defending local democracy. And I would certainly support them in their campaigns, but I don't feel it's right for me to tell them precisely how to do it.
There's one here from Mr. Flips from Yule, who wonders what you do in your spare time, because you don't seem to have much of it.
Well, I'm only one of my family still live at home, but I see an awful lot of my family, and I watch television. And when I have a little time, which in the summer I do a little bit of carpentry, not very well, but I enjoy that. I like taking photographs. But my main interest is in this, because politics is life, really. Everything you come up against is in some way political, because politics is about how people react and behave one with another. So that you mustn't think that I find it a burden. I find it a pleasure. And I read and write and so on.
Do you find it easy to relax?
Yes, I do, actually. I've never had any difficulty in sleeping. And occasionally, you know, if you've got some very big problem, maybe it keeps you awake, but I'm asleep within a few moments of putting my head on the pillow, I've got a very, very supportive family, and that makes all the difference in the world.
Mr. Roger Evans from Swansea asks, if the Labour Party was now in power, what would Mr. Benn do about the rail dispute?
Well, I believe that the ASLEF drivers are right, 100% right, and I want to make
why?
This clear. I tell you why, because they were promised the 3% last summer. And the pay, the 8% basic rate and the 3% extra was agreed by the Railway Board. And I think the Railway Board have broken their word. And I think it's very unfair that highly skilled and responsible people like engine drivers and footplate men should be denied their money. Inflation is 12%. So, you know, it's surprising in a way that anybody should think that engine drivers should have their wages cut. And they drive very sophisticated equipment, and the safety of the lives of people is at stake, and I support them 100%.
But I thought both sides, both management and union, have agreed that it is not about the 3% that has been accepted, but about flexible rostering.
Oh, but they won't pay the money until the unions capitulate on this flexible rostering, which means actually the abolition of the 8-hour day, on which the unions scored a notable victory in 1918. And I believe that the engine drivers are being treated scandalously by the press and by the media generally, because they are people who have an immensely responsible job. They were promised the money and they are being blackmailed now, I'm putting it bluntly, by the British Railway Board, and I think they should get the money. So it's an easy question to answer outright. Give them the money they've been promised and then negotiate about the question of the rostering in the future.
So you're saying if you were in power you would I'm using a word that sounds very emotive, give in to their demands.
No, I wouldn't. I would not talk about giving in. I'm saying the British Rail should honour the obligation they've entered into with the railmen. I don't do giving in at all. They promised them the money, and now they're withholding the money in order to force them out of the eight-hour day into a rostering system which would be very unfair and would not be effective. And I believe that the British Railway Board, and they're a nationalised industry, but I say it bluntly, they are responsible, with the government in the background withholding money, they are responsible for the troubles on the railways, and commuters are held up and travellers are held up, should put the blame where it lies, with the Railway Board and behind them with the Cabinet.
One here from Wales, from Brimley Davis, from Abergavenny, you spoke of that. Does Mr. Benn believe that Britain will become a one-party state?
Well, no. I mean, I believe in democracy. Everything I've done in my life, I mean, this is really where you'd have to read the Sun or the Mail or the Daily Mirror for years to believe that sort of thing. Everything I've done in my life has been about democracy. I mean, the referendum which we heard about, I campaigned for years to give the British people the right to vote. They didn't vote the way I wanted, but that's not the point. The industrial democracy, the workers' cooperatives, the open government, the Freedom of Information Act, all the things that I've ever done in my life, if I have to describe it, have been to open up, to disseminate power, and I'm totally opposed to a one-party state. My fear is that if you had the SDP and the Liberals joining with the Tories after the next election, there might be a danger of that, but I'm absolutely committed 100% to the democratic process.